are looking at sentences, and we are looking at sentences to understand underlying patterns of language. Underlying patterns help us relationship between language and mind. And while looking at sentences, we have moved to a point where we are looking at certain operations taking place, and certain operations that are part of underlying patterns of language, and they are taking place at a different level of representation. They are also called different levels of representation in mind. One of the things that we have seen of that type is displacement. Displacement was the phenomena where one element from one position in a sentence moves to another. Such a thing happens in language with specific motivations and proper evidence that we have seen so far. We are looking at one more such phenomena, one more evidence in support of displacement of elements from one position to another, and this is called passivization. That is, we are taking examples from passivization to understand displacement. Earlier, we have looked at displacement in terms of questions. Now, to understand displacement with one more evidence, let's look at an example of passivization. That is, let's first understand examples of passive sentences. Look at these sentences. Sri Lanka beat India in the T20 World Cup final. The passive sentence is, India were beaten in the T20 World Cup final. India were beaten in the T20 World Cup final. Please look at the distinction between the two sentences. Sri Lanka beat India in the T20 World Cup final. This is the active sentence. The passive one is, India were beaten in the T20 World Cup final. Where I am trying to draw your attention is, by Sri Lanka is not necessarily mentioned. And even if we do in a sentence, that is considered as a PP, and it comes with the help of a preposition. Police caught the thief in the second sentence. To look at underlying patterns, we are looking at one more evidence from passivization in support of displacement, particularly movement of one NP from one position in a sentence to another. We have looked at one such example of displacement in terms of question words. That is, when we question a sentence, when we question a particular element in a sentence, we see that the element in the question drops, and in place of that, we have another element outside IP. So, that gives us a structural evidence in support of movement of one element in a sentence to another. Today, we are looking at passivization, and an understanding of passive sentences will help us understand how an element moves from one position to the other as an evidence of displacement. And in such a case, in such a scenario, we will also examine motivation for this type of displacement in natural language, and subsequently we will try to understand that how such a thing at another level of mental representation takes place underlyingly in a sentence, for us to understand how displacement works and how human mind finds out underlying patterns in language. Let's look at two examples of each: active sentences and passive sentences. Sri Lanka beat India in T20 World Cup final. This is an active sentence. where Sri Lanka is the subject of this sentence, beat is the verb, and India is the object of the sentence, and T20 World Cup final is another one. In the passive counterpart, we see India were beaten in T20 World Cup final. If we want to put an information, we can say by Sri Lanka. However, that's not a required element. Preceded by a preposition, that can be dropped, or that gets the status of an adjunct in a sentence in passive. This has got consequences, and we will look at it little later. The second example, exactly the same thing, same process repeating, police caught the thief. The passive one, thief was caught. So, we don't need to repeat police. In other words, what we see as the subject of the sentence in an active sentence, in the passive sentence, that whole element somehow becomes insignificant, and sometimes it appears as an adjunct and sometimes it's not even required. That's a significant point, significant differences at the level of observation that we can see between active and passive. To understand how the morphology part of passive sentences operate, we take an example from English to see where we see that the passive verbs are actually verb be plus participial form of the verb. Verb be and the participial form of the verb. So, take the example again, the part of beaten and caught. So, when we say beaten, look at the passive sentence. We are saying India were beaten. Were as the part of be, and beaten is participle form. The thief was caught, was as an example of verb be, and caught as an example of participle. So, this is the structure that is going to be available in English sentences all along. And that's an important part of passive morphology. What happens because of this is we find that such a combination of verb, such a combination does not allow an NP with a theta role in the subject position. Okay? Therefore, we see the suppression of the subject elements like Sri Lanka in the first sentence and police in the other one. The verb with be plus participle also does not assign accusative case to their complements. So it's very interesting phenomena. What happens is very simple. So police caught the thief. What we are saying in the passive, what happens is we get the verb like this. Was caught, and was caught, and what we see is this is an example of verb be, and this is an example of participle. The feature of this verb is such that it doesn't allow a subject with a, it doesn't allow an NP with a theta role. Please understand, on the basis of our understanding of underlying patterns of sentences so far that we have seen, this is an agent. An agent is the thematic role assigned to this NP. So, in a passive sentence, this is not going to be allowed here. Therefore, this is dropped or becomes an adjunct at the end of the sentence. And what we see as a consequence, because this is the central thing of the passive sentence. So what this does is this also does not have the capacity to assign accusative case to its complements. Now, this is the motivation for displacement. What we find that, so when we, what is the object of the verb here? The thief. Now, this NP is not going to be allowed here because this is not going to be case assigned by the passive verb. All right? So, what we see as features of passives, as you see on the screen, that the passive verb morphology gets affected, and compared to the active sentence, this is what we get as passive verb. This doesn't allow an external theta role, or an element this can't assign a theta role. At the same time, it doesn't allow an NP that carries a theta role here. Similarly, it can't assign a structural case or accusative case structurally to the complement. This creates a very strange situation for us. So what we see, again, look at the screen and try to understand this thing carefully with the sentence, Sri Lanka beat India. Sri Lanka has the theta role agent, it's the subject of the sentence. Beat is the verb, it's a transitive verb. India is an internal argument of the verb beat, is an object, direct object of the verb. Gets the objective case structurally from the verb beat. Everything is in place. The subject Sri Lanka gets nominative case from the finite IP, and the object gets accusative case structurally from the verb beat. That is, verb beat and the object is India. Everything is taken care of. As a consequence of this, what we find is in the passive verb, we have the spec of IP position empty, and we find this thing not getting case because it's not allowed. So what we see that this is caseless and this position is empty. This is the motivation of movement of an NP in the passives. So what we find eventually is this NP moves to this position and acquires case in this position, because this position is minus theta position but plus case position. So the finiteness assigns case to the NP, the thief, which did not have a case in the beginning, in a passive sentence. All right? And thus we see a very compelling reason for a displacement, and this becomes an evidence for displacement in natural languages. Sentences are not allowed to have an NP without cases. We cannot have an NP without a case in a sentence. Therefore, because the caseless NP is not permitted, becomes the motivation. That becomes the motivation for an NP, for the displacement of an NP in a different position. And luckily, in this situation, we find that the spec of IP is available for such a movement. This movement is within IP, compelled by case filter, and therefore we get the structure preserved. So following the case filter, the D structure of a passive results into ungrammaticality, because it can't allow, at the deepest structure it cannot allow a NP without a case here. I am repeating this thing again and again for you to see the motivation for displacement in natural languages. And this displacement happens at the deeper structure of the underlying patterns, and it is figured out by human mind as part of its normal acquisition of patterns. And we get everything in place once the movement takes place, and therefore we say movement, displacement of elements from one position to the other in natural languages is a required phenomena, and such a displacement happens at a deeper level of representation, helps us understand a level further deep from where we understand patterns of languages, from where human mind internalizes patterns underlying language. This is an example of movement. So we have seen evidence of displacement, at the same time motivation for such a displacement, and then the examples of displacement, also how phrase structure takes care of this displacement. Thus we reach to the conclusion that displacement is an internal part of structure preservation of natural languages. Thank you.